This week, our Motherish team joins forces with St. Jude Children's Research Hospital to create awareness on giving and how we could join the fight to help end childhood cancer. Today, we chat with Maria Belen, a mother of a St. Jude patient who not only shares her amazing testimony of a mother's unconditional love and strength, but also motivates to give from a place of gratitude.
We read the books, we bought the things. We thought we were ready. And then life took our plans and changed them. I'm Karen, I'm Victoria's mommy, and I work in tech.
And I'm Pamela. I have a baby boy named Ford, and I'm a journalist. And although we're both first-time working moms, we're actually pretty different.
And that's totally okay. Because we both agree that our most important work is raising our kids. We really need each other and can only get through this together. Welcome to Motherish Moments.
Hello, hello.
Hi, Bella. Welcome to Motherish Moment. This is a very special episode because we're joining forces with a very special cause, St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. What better way to explain the purpose of St. Jude and how special it is than through a testimony of a mother? And I was inspired and touched in a very special way by the St. Jude moms because they're like superheroes. Mm-hmm. You know, you'll get to hear from Maria Belen and like how they find the strength and the love to get them through something like dealing with their child with cancer. Mm-hmm. It's amazing and it's unique. And I think Maria Belen's testimony is going to change us for the best.
Are you ready for your motherish moment?
Yeah. So my motherish moment this week was we got the Christmas tree. It's up. It's beautiful. And this was the first year that Ford got to decorate with us and put the little balls. Yes. And it's nice. People always talked about Christmas being so much better when you have children. And yes. Now I get it. Yeah, I get it. I mean, yes. He was a baby last year. And the first year, this is his third Christmas. And it's right. It just gets better and better. And he's so excited. And I think he kind of understands a little bit. I don't think he gets like the Santa. And
yeah,
all that stuff
a lot.
Yet.
It's still very confusing.
We went through the catalogs and kind of pointed. But I don't think he gets that I could actually buy that for him or he's going to get that. So he kind of just... So little by little, but this year, definitely the tree and the decoration of it was a big highlight for us.
Which is a super special part of it. Well, my motherish moment is related and it's like fast forwarding 1 year later for your life. But basically with Victoria, we also decorated the tree. She now has her own tree in her room.
That's cute. For us, a little
pink tree in her room. She got really into the ornament situation. So she decided to shop for ornaments on my tree. And so she's like, Mommy, este no lo necesitas. Nunca tuve un tigre. Like, aww, as an ornament. And I'm like, okay. So she's taking all my ornaments from my
tree
into her tree in her room. So I'm like, okay. And then with the gift situation, I think I mentioned this in another moment, but like, we're still taking photos at stores of all the things that she wants.
Is there like a limit amount that Santa brings or?
Listen, no. Santa's bringing one thing. I'm sorry. Like, no. Santa's bringing one thing.
I told you that last year I didn't buy a single gift for Ford. I only re-gifted everything he had gotten from like my coworkers and friends and put him under the tree. He didn't notice.
I
got criticized a little bit. Like, you didn't get enough. I'm like, this year I'm going through a similar path, even though I made him like one big gift.
Yeah.
Because his reactions are so cute now. Like, he gets excited.
So. But what's it called? Yeah, we're still taking pictures of everything. So we were like in New York, toy stores and everything. She's like, mommy, la foto para Santa. And like, she like poses and I'm like,
with the actual gift.
Yes. And I'm like, what does she, am I going to have to print these photos out? Like, I don't really know what I got myself into, but
I like that idea.
She's going to ask for like accountability over this. Like, she's going to be like, what are you doing with this? So I have to figure that out. But yeah, that's my motherish moment.
So why don't we ask Maria Belen? Hi, Maria Belen. Welcome to Motherish. Why don't we start with your motherish moment of the week?
So I'm on a different level right now because my kids are teenagers.
Yes.
I'm trying to learn about, you know, how to have more patience and, you know, just love them. But my daughter is 16 and she has highlighted hair and she's been saying that she wanted to dye her hair a different color because she just wants to. And she just dyed her hair blonde like 2 months ago. And I'm like, why? I just pay for your hair. Why you want to change it right now? I don't know. I just want to change. You know, I want something different.
Oh my God.
She took me to Target to look at sprays, you know, for the hair, but that didn't work. So I was like, I'm not going to pay for your hair again because I just paid for your hair. And she's like, I still want something different. And I'm like, okay, here, take this shampoo. and it's gonna dye your hair like, you know, like mine. And that way, you know, you can just try it and see if you like it or not. And she did it. I told her to try it on one, you know, just
like a little piece of hair.
Yeah, and she's like, no, I'm just gonna do it. Oh, I'm gonna do it all. Okay. And she did it and she's like, I don't know, I don't like it. I wanna be blonde. And it's just funny to me because we've been going through teenage. My son, Sebastian, he's 15 and he's also changing. So to me, all that is new. And it's just, at the beginning was a little bit hard to understand them. But now I just, you know, I just go with the flow. So I just laugh at her and just tell her, you know, whatever, you can just wash it off tomorrow and it'll be blonde again. So that will be my motherish moment of the week.
Bueno, Maria Belen, welcome officially to Motherish Moments. We coordinated with St. Jude to have you join us so you could share your testimony. Tell us, like, how did your life change in 2014?
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for this opportunity to talk about St. Jude. I feel like there's a lot of people that still don't know what, or the whole, or, you know, what St. Jude does to the families, you know, like mine. So in 2014, my son got diagnosed with a brain tumor and I got referred to St. Jude. The doctors didn't tell us he had cancer, so we never told him he had cancer. And I think from the moment that he had the surgery, and then after 2 weeks that we got the results that the tumor was a malignant tumor, from that day on, I think our life changed forever.
How old was Sebastian and what were the symptoms he was?
Yeah, he was 6 years old and he was a very, very active boy and he would never, you know, complain about anything. And this time he complained about having a headache and he just complained like, you know, like for 5 or 10 minutes and then we'll be on the run. So I took him to the doctor. They told me he had like a sinus infection, but then the headaches continued for like a week. He was fine when we got to the hospital. So they said, no, he's fine. He's just, you know, just like a headache. So the second time I went to the hospital and I was like, you know what? He's complaining a lot. He's crying. At this point, he was screaming. You know, it wasn't that long. It took like maybe a week or a week and a half. So at this point, I was like, please, he's complaining. He's crying. Because when I got to the hospital, he was, you know, he was like playing. And I was like, oh my God, no, they're gonna, you know, they're gonna think I'm crazy. But I was like, I felt as a mom, you feel like something is different. Something is not right. So I had that feeling in my gut. And I was like, please help me. So, okay, they did a CT scan. They told me, you know, right after the CT scan that he had a brain tumor and that he needed surgery. It was really fast. And then he had surgery the next day. And then that day after the surgery, you know how the doctors told you that it's a very serious surgery, that they didn't know the outcome. They didn't know if he was going to be able to speak or write or walk or, you know. But we always had faith that everything was going to be fine. And the doctor came out and he said the tumor is a malignant tumor, but the surgery went fine. I was just so thankful that he was fine and the surgery was good that I think I didn't hear what he said. I was just happy that the surgery was done and that he was fine. So I didn't really like, I think we went through a process of understanding what was going on and, you know, and getting, I think, accepting what was happening.
Like processing everything.
Yes, I was, you know, I was praying to God that he could do anything in his power to change the diagnostic. We had to wait after the surgery. We had to wait for, I think it was almost 3 weeks for the results of the biopsy. And I was praying to God that, you know, I was saying, I know you can change the results. I know you can change, you know, I know you can do whatever, you know, it's in your power. And my faith was always focused on that, you know, that God is God. But after the 2 or 3 weeks, we received the results and the doctors told us that, you know, our best option was St. Jude. I didn't know much about St. Jude. I think I just saw, you know, like the commercials, but I didn't really know. And my daughter at that time was 8 and it was almost the end of the school year. So when he said, okay, you have to go to St. Jude, I remember that day, I felt like a feeling that I never had before, that I was gonna faint, you know, that I don't know. So I think that day is when we really realized what was going on and that it was something serious. Because I think we didn't want to accept the fact that he had cancer. Like I said, we never told him he had cancer. We never treated him like he was sick, nothing. So when he said, you have to go to St. Jude in Memphis and you have to go live there, we couldn't believe, you know, what's going on. And we thought about our daughter, and I prayed to God for a door, to open the door for the best for him. And he gave us St. Jude. When the doctor said that, we were like, you know, this is our best option, because we were praying in those 3 weeks that went through, that we didn't know, you know, what was it, the outcome going to be. We were praying to God, and when they said the St. Jude, then we were, you know, this is what God wants us, you know, to go through. So we weren't afraid at that time. I think being scared about him was, you know, like something that was building later in the process. We took just our bags and my daughter, my son, my husband, we went there and we thought, you know, our lives are gonna change now. We're gonna live in Memphis. Nothing was certain. We just didn't know, nothing. We were so lost. But when we got to St. Jude, they have everything that is so organized in a way that when you get there, even though families feel like lost, like we felt.
It's crazy how fast your life could change, right? Like you had an active, healthy boy, and then next thing you know, you're packing your stuff and you're moving to St. Jude.
Yeah, they called us on a Friday and they said, okay, you can come on Monday. I told my mom and my mother-in-law, okay, you know, whatever is in the house, you can sell it. We're just gonna move to Memphis. My husband was gonna quit his job. So when we got to St. Jude and we talked to a social worker, because they have everything. As soon as you get there, as soon as you walk through those doors, you have a lot of people that go, you know, that support you in every way that sometimes we don't think. As parents, we like to think that we think about everything, but sometimes we don't.
What did the doctors tell you, Maria Belen, when you got to St. Jude? What was the prognosis? What were his chances? I know it's a very common childhood cancer, the brain cancer that Sebastian had, but what were they telling you at that point?
They told us that he had a percentage. Sometimes I don't like to say it, but they told me that the treatment, you know, it was an experimental treatment. They told me many things. They told me that he wasn't going to be an intellectual person. Now he's a genius in math. They told me he was going to live like 5 years. By his 12th birthday, I was so afraid that he was going to die when he was 12. And that's the truth. Nobody knows that. I think only my husband and my family. But they gave us 5 years. And I was like, me and my husband, we always thought, you know, oh, that's only numbers, but God is, it's, you know, he's his father. We like to think that God had a plan for him, and we didn't like to think about side effects and the percentage that they gave us and everything, you know, that doctors usually tell you, because sometimes those things happen. But we, you know, we didn't want to give up. We were focused on having faith and go every day, you know, to his treatments and making him feel good. Like I told you, like he wasn't sick. He was just getting a treatment for his headache. That's what he thought. And he was 6. He turned 7 at the hospital on his, I think, first chemo. He turned 7 in September. And we got to St. Jude on June 2014.
For those who haven't been to St. Jude, can you help us explain, Maria Belen, how special it is? And I don't mean to say it in like in a corny way, but like why it's so unique when it comes to treating children with cancer and what they're doing beyond the walls of the hospital.
For us, St. Jude is our home. It's like a family. It's like a big brother. Like there are so many things to say about St. Jude. I always get excited because it's much more than a hospital, and the kindness of people that really sustain this cause. It's like a big family that welcomes you with open arms. And you know, when you have that feeling that you have a family member or somebody that tells you everything is gonna be all right and you can count on me. And St. Jude for us is this person. Even though St. Jude involves a lot of people, we feel like everyone is in the same feeling that they're there to accomplish that mission, which is treat the patients. I mean, and it's not really patients. They really treat you like a family. And when you get to St. Jude, everything is prepared for the families. St. Jude is a place where you can go and you have hope, and everyone there helps you. I have like so many feelings that I don't know how to put in words, but it's just our home. That's the way we feel it. every time we go, we still go. We still go to St. Jude every year. Now we're going every 6 months again. And every time we go, it's like we go to our home. And we know that we're going to go there. And if anything that, you know, Sebastian is dealing with, you know, they're going to help us, you know, live through that or and support us in everything.
And how is Sebastian doing today?
He's a boy full of life. He's a fighter. He's accomplishing everything that he once told me as a little boy that he wanted to play soccer. That right now he's learning by himself to play the guitar. He plays in the marching band. Everything that he wants, he doesn't see obstacles. You know, he's just like, you know, I want to do that, and he does it. Every time I see him, I just feel happy. Before everything happened, you know, I thought that I was enjoying my kids and I thought we were enjoying life. After this experience, everything changes, like inside of us, everything changed. And now I feel like I enjoy more everything. Mm-hmm. Since the moment he wakes up, when I see him all dirty, when he's having a teenage moment, when he's playing in the band in the school, it's like it's so emotional for me. He's 15. He's going through some health stuff after the chemotherapy, but he has a good personality. He has a lot of faith, and he's just a fighter. He probably will need a surgery next year, and he's like, yeah, let's go. And it's a hard surgery. It's a very big surgery, and he's like, yeah, I want it. I want to do it. So he's like, he's a fighter. He's doing very well.
Just one last message, Marie-Malene, for this holiday season. I think we always say, like, there's no better way to give thanks for our healthy children and the health of our children than by, like, supporting other parents that are probably struggling during this season. So just, like, a closing, you know, message for people so they could find them in their heart to kind of just give and why is it important to give?
It's very important to give to St. Jude because they're looking for cures to save the life of children, you know, like mine, and not only for children in the U.S., but for children around the world. And one of the things that we can see with this cause is the kindness of people. This is an idea from, you know, a wish from a man that wanted to, you know, save the life of children. It's functioning because the support of the people. And it's very important for people to know that everything St. Jude does is to support the families that are going through this rough moment. If the hospital doesn't have this support, then they're not going to be able to find more cures. And the tumor that Sebastian had at the beginning wasn't curable. But now, after all this research, they discovered that medulloblastoma was the name. They had 3 different kinds. And because of this research, they were able to save my son's life. And this is also, you know, in part because of the people that support St. Jude. So this holiday season, and I think every day I'm grateful. I thought it was grateful, but now I feel like when you are so close to losing somebody that you love the most, like your kids, you develop something inside of you that makes you cherish everything, every moment. And so now when we, you know, think about being with our families, just I would like to tell the people that to be thankful about, you know, their health, but also to think about the people that is going through this. We don't know, you know, like, you know, I never expected this to happen to my son. And so to people to support St. Jude so they can support the families and the children that are going through a difficult time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.